Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship today, particularly to all the dads who are here with us this morning and watching online. A very happy and blessed Father's Day to you. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious Lord, we come before you to ask your blessing upon our worship today. We thank you, O God, that you come to us as Father. And Lord, as Father, you have called us, your children, to come and worship you today. And you have many good and wonderful gifts to give us as we worship you. So Lord, open our hearts, our minds, our ears to receive from you what you have for us. In your precious name we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's stand for our time of praise. Thanks, everybody. Let's stand up again. Sorry. We don't have kids chat this morning because there's no kids. So the Lord be with you. We are the body of Christ. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, let's share the peace in the usual ways. Okay, you may be seated as Dee's going to read the gospel for us. And I've had a heavy cold and it sort of manifested itself in my throat. So she's going to read the sermon text as well. And then when I share the sermon, Janet's going to come up the front and sit with me as she did in the first service, just in case my voice cracks. And hopefully there will be very little interruption to your worship that way. So thanks, Dee.
I hope my voice is going to last out too. The gospel reading is from Luke 14, verses 25 to 35. That's on page 1034. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able, with 10,000 men, to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation, while the other is still a long way off, and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It isn't fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord. This reading is from Acts chapter 2, 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Hear the word of the Lord. Psalm 95. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in Meribah, as you did that day at Massah in the desert, where your fathers tested and tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years I was angry with that generation. I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declare on oath, in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Dee. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the great privilege we have in coming to be able to worship you today. So, Lord, as we meditate upon your word today, let us grow in our understanding and practice of worship. In your name we pray. Amen. Today we get to do one more in our series, Our Church Grows. So far we've heard messages on our church founded in the gospel, and our church devoted to the word of God. Today, the theme of my message is our church worships God. From our theme verse of Acts 2:42, we see that the first Christians, when they gathered for worship, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer, what we have called the four marks of the church. But if we go on to read a little bit further in Acts 2:46 and 47, we read, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of the people. We often think of the first church as only meeting in homes, but here we see that Luke makes reference to the strong Jewish character of the early church. He makes reference to their faithful temple attendance, because all Jews attended the temple for times of corporate teaching, customary daily prayer, and national worship. Not only did they do that, but they met together in each other's homes. Stephen Gurr, in his commentary on Acts, writes, they habitually ate together enjoying each other's company and carrying on a joyous, ongoing, perpetual, progressive dinner from one home to another. And even today in Israel, as in other ethnic cultures set around the Mediterranean, very little happens apart from food. And as we say, where you have two Jews, you have at least four plates of food. And I think the same can be said for Anglican potlucks. So we see from this that after they became followers of Christ, the first Christians did not abandon their Jewish faith. They participated in the life of the temple. When they became Christian, they didn't want to throw out their religious formality for the sake of religious freedom. They retained both in the context of what we call worship. The church, our church, HTK, worships God. Now, there's nothing startling about that. Worship is central to the life of the church. Worship is a fundamental part of who we are and what we do. It's the only time in the week when the whole church family gets together. And because it is so central and so important, it can cause a great deal of conflict. Do you remember what were infamously called the worship wars? In the 1970s and 80s, worship wars raged at their highest in the church. And it was mainly around the issue of traditional versus contemporary. Some wanted more informal songs like scripture in song, less responsive and formal sounding liturgy, no clerical garb, and so on. And then there were those who would not budge from the traditional worship liturgy. The organ was the musical instrument played in heaven, and also the ministers just had to wear clerical garb or else they weren't really ministers. A whole lot of other stuff went on around that. I lived through it in the Lutheran church, and I'm sure you probably did too, to one degree or another, in the Anglican church. Maybe even then, we should have learnt to be more like the first church, who still lived grounded in the formality and tradition of the Jewish temple and enjoying the informality, the Christian house church movement. When we get all churned up about what songs or hymns are sung or not sung, whether we stand up here or there in the worship service, what words are used in liturgy, or whether the clergy wear robes or not, we're not focusing on the key issues, the key matters of worship. And over the century, Psalm 95 has been one of the key texts that the church has used to help us understand, shape, and inform our worship. So let's have a closer look at Psalm 95 this morning, seeing how it can help us in our understanding of and practice of worship as we focus on our church worships God. In its original setting, this psalm is a portion of a liturgy for the autumn festival in which Israel's God is revealed as creator and Lord of the universe. And he enters upon his reign as king and renews the covenant with his people, calling them to obey the commandments he ordained in that covenant. It was said or sung by the priest or the Levite to the congregation as they actually entered in the temple sanctuary. It's a rather unusual psalm in that the first seven verses contain a hymn preparing the congregation for their encounter with the living God. And the last four verses contain a prophetic warning from God, calling upon the congregation to obey at threat of punishment. And both the hymn of praise and the prophetic warning inform our understanding and practice of worship. Now the psalm begins, "Come." The people worship as a result of God's invitation through the priest to come. Today in the church, we worship because God invites us to come. God motivates us by the call of the gospel to come and worship him. Yes, we might set the alarm, get up, eat our breakfast, shower, put on our Sunday best, and come along to worship. But behind of all of that is the movement of the Holy Spirit. There are many people not at worship in the church today because God has not called them, or because they have hardened their hearts to God's call. And while this is a call to the congregation liturgically by the priest, as the congregation sings it with him, they are giving mutual encouragement to each other to worship. And that is also a part of our call to worship. We not only hear it from God and his movement in our hearts, we share it with each other. We encourage each other to come and worship. We've had a number of members go missing in action during COVID. Have you rung any of them up to see how they're going and encourage them in their worship? It's part of being called to worship. The psalmist goes on to say, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Who is to sing? Us. And what does it say about God's people worshiping God? It is a corporate event. It is something we do together. Over the years, I've gotten tired of all the different people who have told me, I can worship God better by myself in the bush, by the sea, on a boat, or gardening. And indeed, being in those places and doing those activities can be wonderful times of enjoying God and his creation, but they're not worship. The first reason is that you do not know what kind of God is that God of the bush, the sea, the lake, the wind, the soil. How does God feel about you? Do you know who God truly is from those activities? No, you need to gather before God, with God's people, in community, in worship, to know that God is a God of grace, and to receive that grace by the means of grace, the word and the sacraments in worship. You'll never know what God is like out there in creation, even though he does leave his handprints there. The second reason is that worship is not an individual activity. It is a corporate act. Worship is not something you do by yourself. Yes, you can pray, you can sing, you can give praise, but worship, whereby God calls his people to bless them by the Holy Spirit, working through the word and sacraments, and they respond in thanksgiving, cannot happen individually out in the bush, by the sea, on a boat, or in the garden, because worship is corporate. It is where we meet with the God of grace, and he gives us his grace. The first act of worship that the priest calls the people to is to shout aloud to the rock of salvation. The reason why we worship God is because he is our salvation, the rock, the foundation, the strength, the certainty. You'll never find that rock out in nature, no matter the ecstasy of the feeling. God is the one who saved us, as we believe, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So as the psalmist says, let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. God has saved us. There's nothing we could do to save ourselves. We first received this salvation when we were baptized and given the gift of the Holy Spirit and made a member of the church. And we receive this gift anew every time we gather around the word, and particularly around the sacrament of Holy Communion on a Sunday. And it is a certainty, it is a rock upon which we can build our lives. Nothing outside of worship can offer us this. So as God's people, we are a people of thanksgiving. The psalmist goes on to say, "For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands form the dry land." Here we discover that the God of our salvation is the God of creation, the one who made the earth, the mountains, the sea, and the sky. Is the one who we worship as we gather to worship the rock of our salvation. The psalmist doesn't say, worship this God of creation out there in creation, but rather he says, gather together in corporate worship with God's people and worship him there. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. He is the ultimate number one. There's nothing or nobody else like him or that comes near to him. Out of all the gods back then, the people of Israel would have understood this in the context of the Baals and the other pagan gods. But today, more formidable false gods come from money and materialism, sport and leisure, secular humanism and individualism. But none of these can give us what the God of salvation, who is the God of creation, can give us: love, grace, mercy, healing, hope, peace. And so I could go on and on. And because he is such a great God, as the psalmist says, come, let us worship, let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. We bow down and kneel. By our liturgical actions, we express what's in our hearts: humility. Before such a great God, we can only humble ourselves. Because you see, what matters most is the heart. The first and greatest commandment: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of hearts. This awesome and gracious God comes to us to relate to us as a shepherd. The psalmist goes on to say, he is our God and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. God cares for us as a shepherd cares for the sheep. As sheep, we are totally helpless. We constantly rely on God's provision and protection. Without him, we would perish as vulnerable sheep do, out in the wilderness, in harsh conditions, and surrounded by predators. Our worship expresses our recognition of how much we need our God and all that he has to give us. So if this is the kind of God we have, who calls us to worship, where we receive heavenly food and nourishment in corporate gathering, our attitude should be one of joy and thanksgiving, humility and desire to worship. It should not be, as the psalmist goes on to say, today, if you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massah in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested me. They tried me, though they had seen what I did. For 40 years, I was angry with that generation. I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my way. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. You know, this sermon in a nutshell is worship the Lord God with all your heart. And that is the basis of worship, our hearts. These final verses of this psalm warn us about hardening my heart. Psalmist said, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. The greatest challenge to worshiping God with the heart is when you harden the heart. And every Christian can experience the temptation to harden the heart. And it basically happens when we put other people, places, things, and activity ahead of the worship of God. It can result in a heart that becomes callous, hard, uncompassionate, insensitive, and negative towards God. Meribah and Massa were names for the place in the wilderness wanderings of Exodus, where the people of Israel hardened their hearts against God. I won't go into the historical detail, but briefly, there the people of God demonstrated verbal hardening. They quarreled with Moses, thereby they quarreled with God. And in their quarreling with Moses and with God, they put God to the test. It says in Exodus 17:7, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This demonstrated a spiritual hardening. And in their desire to go back to Egypt, where they could have had all the food and drink they wanted, when they complained to Moses and therefore God, they demonstrated a social hardening whereby the ways of the world became more attractive than the ways of God. God calls us to come and worship, but like the Israelites, we too can quarrel with God. We can say no to God for whatever reason we might give. And the next time you can do it again and then again and again and again. And ultimately, you answer his call very seldom, except when you haven't got anything better that you feel you want to do on a Sunday morning, or ultimately you reject his call permanently. It's a verbal hardening. We too can demonstrate a spiritual hardening. Is the Lord among us or not? In these trying times of COVID, it's easy to feel that the Lord has abandoned us. And when we hit testing times in life and God doesn't come through the way we wanted, it's easy to give up on worship. God has let us down. Like the Israelites, we too can demonstrate a social hardening. We'd rather play hockey, go on a family picnic, walk the dog, watch the rugby, than worship God. And what the world offers seems to be more attractive. And while there's nothing wrong with these activities, they take the place of number one, God. And so this hardening of heart, verbal, spiritual, and social, ends up with one result. As it says, God says at the end of the psalm, "They shall never enter my rest." So you see, worship is much more than just attending a service. If that's all it is, it's easy just to give it a miss. But what is worship? Worship is actually answering the call of God to come and be blessed by him. It's a call to come and receive from him the grace that he has for you in the word and in the sacraments. And because it is so great a call, we encourage each other in our worship. Worship is a corporate act whereby we gather together as the family of God before our God, who is creator, redeemer, and sanctifier. And we respond to all that he has given us in thanksgiving and humility with all of our hearts because of his great grace. Our desire, therefore, is to worship him and not harden our hearts, because we know what great blessings and mercies and love we receive in worship. So let us truly be HTK, our church that worships God. Amen. So, Lord, we thank you for the wonderful blessings you give us when we come together around the word and the sacraments each Sunday. Lord, help us to value each and every week this wonderful gospel call to come into your presence and to receive from you and to respond to you with joy and thanksgiving, humility and desire. So, Lord, grow us in our understanding and practice of worship. May the truths of Psalm 95 grow us. In your name we pray. Amen. So I invite you to stand, and Janet's going to lead us in the affirmation of faith and also in the prayers for today.
So let us share this affirmation of faith. I believe I need a shepherd because I am sometimes timid and at other times overconfident, because I often don't know the best path, yet pretend I do, because I rush into dead ends or lead others into hazardous places, because my brightest ideas are seamed with darkness, because the things I crave may not be what is good for me. I need a shepherd. I believe in Jesus, the best possible shepherd. His wisdom leads me to the optimum opportunities. His word comforts me when I'm anxious or afraid. His arm steadies me when I feel weary and heavy laden. His wounded body displays the cost of my rescue. I believe in Jesus, the best possible shepherd. I believe that I do not find him, but he finds me, that I am under his care by virtue of sheer grace. The love he gives me is to be shared with others, that he treasures my name and prepares a place for me, that his fold transfixes earth and heaven. I trust Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Amen. So please sit for a time of prayer. As we lift our concerns, our hopes, our dreams to our great God. God of love, we thank you that you sought us out, that you spoke to us through your Spirit, that we heard your voice, turned to you and followed you. We pray for all those throughout the world who hear your voice and call upon your name. We pray for Christians everywhere, your church throughout the world. We give you thanks for the witness that they bear in the communities where they find themselves, where you have placed them. Give them and us all strength and courage to go forward in your name, trusting in you at all times, sharing the joy of fellowship in your name with those around us. We pray in this parish particularly for Father Steve as he leads us, and for our parish council and all parish leaders. We ask your blessing on each of us as we go about our daily business for you, in your name, reaching out your hand of friendship and fellowship, speaking your words of love and hope and forgiveness in our community. We lift before you today those who are sick, those known to us, and those only known to you, but dear to you as well. We hold them before you, ask your wisdom for the doctors and medical staff treating them, and for your healing blessings to pour down and anoint them. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God who heals, not only physical wounds, but mental and spiritual ones too. We give you thanks, loving God, for all those whose lives have brought honour and glory to you, and we thank you that we, with them, can share in that great fellowship of believers throughout the ages, singing your praises and worshipping you forever. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So let's stand and
farewell. Our online viewers, with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And we sing, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Future sure.